In the early 90s, gaming was already a billion-dollar industry, but at the same time, production teams were still relatively small, and thus even startup companies could work on high-profile titles. Among them was Ancient, founded by composer Yuzo Koshiro. Sega's Revenge of Shinobi had been a huge stepping stone for the composer to kick off his freelance career. The game was very well received, especially its cutting-edge soundtrack. Subsequently, Koshiro continued to work for Sega on their new beat-em-up, Bare Knuckle, better known as Streets of Rage in the West. Both games had been developed by Sega's consumer division, led by Noriyoshi Oba. In the midst of these projects, Koshiro revealed his interest in game design to one of the managers at Sega. Strong personal connections are key in the creative industry. It's not just your portfolio that counts, but the goodwill to award you a job is equally important. Koshiro never developed a game before, but thanks to his success, executive manager Tomio Takami entrusted him with a very important project, an 8-bit port for their upcoming flagship title, Sonic the Hedgehog. Yuzo Koshiro had already established a company called Ancient for a legal partnership with Sega a year prior. His mother took care of the business side, while his sister, Ayano Koshiro, was the first to be hired as lead designer. The Koshiro siblings had worked together on multiple projects. To complete the team, he contracted a programmer and pixel artist whom he had befriended and collaborated with previously. Together, they started porting Sega's high-profile game. The initial concept was to stay as close as possible to the original in terms of game structure, but they soon realized that deviating from its 16-bit brother in a number of ways would be beneficial. Half of the original zones were ultimately replaced by levels that would suit the much less powerful hardware. They had a greater focus on platforming, yet still kept some of the high-speed gameplay for the core essence. Thanks to these changes, the game could hold its own against the impressive Mega Drive release. Sega's trust in the startup company Ancient had paid off, as the 8-bit port became a huge commercial and critical success. Convincing high-profile companies like Konami and Capcom to develop for their Mega Drive was still one of the biggest challenges Sega faced. Capcom's fighter Street Fighter II was a smash hit in the arcade, and it would only be a matter of time before a port would appear on either Nintendo or Sega's consoles. Sega's president, Hayao Nakayama, had been desperately attempting to convince Capcom to port Street Fighter II over to the Mega Drive after its release, initially to no success. At the start of 1992, Capcom had started development for the competing platform, the Super Nintendo. Nakayama knew that Street Fighter II would be a bombshell for Nintendo, and saw the urge to hit back. During an annual party at their Tokyo headquarters, he personally invited the Ancient crew to his private room. Being pleased with their quality work on Sonic for the 8-bit platforms, he entrusted them with a special project. Nakayama encouraged Ancient to make the best fighting game on the Mega Drive that would match the success of Capcom's mega hit. This ambitious project would become Streets of Rage 2. Yuzo Koshiro hit the ground running, as there was no time to lose in the tight development cycle that spanned only 6 months. Mere days after the initial meeting with Nakayama, Sega provided him with a Street Fighter II arcade board to analyze. As a fan of video games, Yuzo became addicted to playing the fighter every day. While he analyzed the game mechanics of Capcom's fighter, he started mapping out the structure for Streets of Rage 2. Within a few weeks, he had come up with stages, the core fighting system, and ideas for characters. His sister Ayano had joined him to visually develop his ideas. She would further expand the roster of enemies and characters and contribute to their moveset. The decision was made early on to drop Adam as a playable character and replace him with two more unique fighters, the bulky wrestler Max and the agile Skate. They were both designed to give the player a different experience, thereby adding replay value. Inspiration for the new character Skate came from browsing through trendy magazines. Ayano Koshiro would cut out interesting images and slap them onto a mood board. Streets of Rage 2 is literally filled with references to things that the development crew loved. The characters Sawyer and Beano, for example, were named after soybean candy, while the popular Baki manga series inspired bosses like Shiva. Ancient was still a small company, not equipped to handle production of Streets of Rage 2 on their own. they contracted freelance artists and the company Shout Design Works to help out on production. Kotaru Uchimura from Shout Design Works would handle the main programming of the game, assisted by their own game designer and pixel artists. The team at Ancient would continue to develop ideas for enemies and flesh out the stages. Alongside familiar themes from the previous game, new settings were added to the mix. Extra care was put into linking the widely differing locations together to add a sense of cinematic progression for the player. A fine example is the first area, in which our heroes fight their way through the downtown streets and a bar. The bartender leaves once in their sight and readies himself for a back-alley brawl. Stages were further infused with interactive elements. Ancient made numerous sketches, but like all creative projects, not all ideas ended up in the final game for one reason or another. Meetings were held at both Ancient and Shout almost weekly. When one of the team members came up with a new idea, they would gather around a programmer and try to implement it in a rough form on the spot. This hands-on approach with a quick turnaround really helped the creative process, as concepts could be tested rather quickly, like allowing Max to hit back-facing enemies with his pipe swing by altering a few parameters. But working with a subcontract development company and freelance artists came with its struggles. In those days, the options to transfer data were limited. They had to rely on a fax machine to transfer concept art and sketches. A producer at Sega and the director of the original Streets of Rage were also kept in the loop and checked on the planning and progress from time to time. Meanwhile, Street Fighter II remained popular among the Ancient crew. Some visitors had jokingly asked if they were actually working on their Streets of Rage project at all. One of the gameplay elements inspired by Street Fighter II was the combo system. Implementing it in their game would help to differentiate it from most other beat-em-ups on the market. The number of attacks was also significantly expanded, including two life-draining powerful attacks that added depth to the gameplay. Sega had assigned the game a massive 16 megabit cartridge. This was not only four times larger than the original, but also made it one of the first Sega games to be put on such a large ROM. Sega knew the added cost was necessary to compete with the 16 megabit Street Fighter II port for the Super Nintendo. The added memory resulted in larger character sprites and more varied levels. Ayano Koshiro was already a seasoned pixel artist, working for multiple platforms and renowned for her speed and quality. She found the Mega Drive to be a great system, despite its limited color palette. The wider screen resolution compared to the competition made it favorable to her. Working with freelance designers made the art direction role of Ayano even more important. It was her responsibility to make sure that all pixel art had the same consistent style and level of quality. The opening stage especially demonstrates a lot of skill and knowledge on how to light a scene. The pavement is a good example. With just a handful of different tiles, they were able to simulate reflections and the soft nighttime shadows. The subtle bluish overall tint in the foreground art also helped to give the stage a nighttime atmosphere. Ayano had taken notice of the sophisticated waterfall dither pattern in Sonic the Hedgehog and decided to implement dither effects in their game to simulate transparency. Ancient had their own pixel art tool called the Ancient Sprite Tool, running on the Sharp X86000. The sprite tool allowed them to manage tile sets efficiently. To help the crew plan out the memory allocation of graphical assets, Sega provided them with special grid paper that visually represented a game screen of their console. All consoles of that era worked with palettes to display all on-screen colors. Sprite and background tiles simply linked to these palettes to get their color. The Mega Drive video chip had four available palettes with 16 colors each. Developers often split them evenly among sprites and background art. Palettes also allowed for enemy color variants. They used the same base artwork stored on the game cartridge. By linking them to a different palette, enemy color variants could be implemented efficiently. But you have to realize that all playable characters, enemies, items, and even weapons shared the same two palettes. A lot of thought had to be put into organizing them to make sure a palette swap worked for all enemies and didn't affect the player characters and items. One of the high points of the original Streets of Rage was certainly its soundtrack, bringing the latest club music to the gaming scene. With the sequel, Yuzo Koshiro continued this vision. In 1992, the Detroit-based electronic music genre known as techno started to amass a large following. Freelance composer Motohiro Kawashima was a big fan of this upcoming genre. He was hired by Ancient to work on games like Shinobi 2 for the Game Gear. Impressed by his work, Koshiro asked him to help compose music for Streets of Rage 2. Kawashima was a regular face at clubs like Space Lab Yellow, located a few blocks away from one of Tokyo's largest nightlife districts. The two composers would visit the establishments frequently to indulge themselves in the latest club music. Inspired by the beats, they would try to recreate them on the Mega Drive hardware working from their own apartments. During his career, Koshiro steadily expanded his studio with new equipment. For the Streets of Rage series, the Roland TR-909 drum machine was a key piece in his collection. This legendary piece of kit was used by many early house pioneers and was therefore linked with this genre. When it came to composing and programming the music for Streets of Rage 2, he would still use his trusted PC-88. Together with a friend, he wrote his own sequencer and audio driver to give him full control. The latter is a small program that runs on the Mega Drive audio processor and controls its two audio chips. One of them is a Yamaha FM audio chip. FM synthesis was commercialized by Yamaha in the early 80s and immediately popularized by their famous DX7 synthesizer. Various arcade boards and consumer hardware would also use Yamaha's FM technology. In audio synthesis, instruments are artificially replicated by altering the pitch, volume, and harmonics of a generated waveform. Via FM, you modulate this waveform with another to create complex new sounds. It was notorious for its complexity and took a lot of skill to make quality custom synthesized instruments. Yuzo already had years of working with FM under his belt before he started composing for the Mega Drive and would make full use of its other audio features as well. For example, the Yamaha FM chip inside the Mega Drive also had one channel that could play back pre-recorded audio samples. In Streets of Rage 2, the kick and the snare were sampled from the TR-909 to give the score its club music foundation. Sampling the short drum recordings only took up a small amount of storage space. The FM chip had a total of 6 channels, basically meaning that 6 sounds could play simultaneously. It was a big step up from most 8-bit systems, but still no luxury. For example, the piano music playing during the bar scene already used up 3 channels. Add a bass and percussion, and there's little left for anything else. Here is where the programmable sound generator comes into play. This straightforward audio chip generated iconic 8-bit bleeps for all Sega Master System games. The chip was included in the Mega Drive for backwards compatibility, but was also used by many composers to give their score an extra layer of substance. Just listen to the same bar music with the added PSG channels. Koshiro's preferred method of working was to compose with the specific level in mind. He would therefore wait till a level was playable and be inspired by the artwork and its dynamic. It allowed him to create a synergy between the visuals and sound. Koshiro delivered the bulk of the score and would use a mixture of popular styles of that era, from smooth neo-soul to house and techno. Kawashima added the harder techno edge to the soundtrack, with techno tracks like Expander. A portion of the appointed 16 megabits of memory was dedicated to audio samples for music and sound effects. In all fighting games, the impact or hit sound effect is important to convey the strength and feel of a blow. The team therefore made sure the sound effect had the right punch to it. Koshiro himself did most of the voices in the game using an Akai S1100 digital sampler to record them, and some of Sega's proprietary tools to convert them into a Mega Drive compatible format. The composer had a real affinity for electronic audio equipment and would keep expanding his studio in the following years. While Yuzo was working on the soundtrack, Ayano Koshiro would handle communications between their company, Sega, and the contracted parties. The gameplay would undergo numerous tweaks late in development, For example, extending the range of attacks in 3D space to make it easier to hit multiple enemies, and so cancelling interrupts by bad guys who are just out of range. The project was quickly nearing its deadline. Sega had wanted to have the game in store before the holiday season, but Ayano Koshiro guarded the quality of the game and fought for more development time. The project had become dear to them while working on it daily and passionately into the late hours. In the fall of 1992, the final game build was signed off, and the following months, the distribution process started. Hundreds of thousands of cartridges, boxes, and manuals were created and shipped to stores all over the world. Streets of Rage 2 became readily available at the start of 1993. Thanks to the passion, dedication, and creative work environment, Ancient succeeded in making the best fighter on the system, one that could hold its own against Capcom's mega hits. Ancient continued to work for Sega on the critically acclaimed Story of Thor, and so the initial trust management at Sega had put in the dream of the young composer had worked out great. Ancient developed three mega hits during the 16-bit generation for the company, and so became one of their most important partners. But all their success aside, Ancient remained a small and thus agile company, allowing them to quickly adapt in the ever-changing video game market. Not having the burden of running a huge company allowed Yuzo to focus on what he likes best: composing awesome music.